Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. In case you couldn't tell, I have gone and lost my voice. But hey, what are you going to do? It's Monday evening. We're here to do the thing we do on Monday evenings, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. But there is a thing that I'm going to be doing quite a lot this evening, which is this. Which is muting the microphone to cough. Now, if you can believe it, a couple of weeks ago, we did a stream on setting goals and I complained, oh, woe is me, about being really ill for the stream. Well, guys, it's back. There's this weird thing going around in the UK right now. I don't know if any of our UK friends have experienced this, where there's this flu thing and the flu arrives and then you get it, you feel better, and then it comes back. And I've spoken to about 12 or 15 people who've had exactly the same experience, which explains why my beard is so grizzly. I've literally just noticed that. But anyway, listen, it's Monday evening. I'm going to stop complaining. Thank you so much for joining us. We are here to do the thing we do on Monday evenings, which is hang out and talk about the guitar. And today, we are discussing how you can improve the health, strength, and dexterity of the things that actually do the playing with the creation and development of some specific and targeted finger exercises. But if you're joining us for the first time, or if you're a returning viewer who is part of our growing community of stream attendees, I want to thank you for joining us. It's great to have you on board. Couple of little bits of housekeeping. Ways you can help us keep the lights on, you can keep me in Cavonia cough medicine, is by going to the link, which is down here. This is the link for GI Plus, where you can go and get more guitar lessons, a little like the one we're doing today, but in much greater detail. We've just dropped a few courses over the last couple of months. We have many more coming, over the course of 2023. All manner of stuff. Practice templates is going to be dropping soon. We have a course called All About Arpeggios. We have additional resources for mastering modes. We've got a metal rhythm guitar course. All of that and so much more is coming not in the not too distant future. But yes, if you're not signed up already, maybe today is the day, right? GI Plus, it is down there, says so up here, so it must be true. Other ways you can help us with the streams, if you're getting some use out of the things we're doing here, if you're enjoying what we are giving you, these streams will always be available for you for free on YouTube, on social media, for as long as we're doing them, which is going to be the foreseeable future, because try and stop me, I'm having a great time. So anyway, listen, ways you can help us is you can share this stream with your guitar playing friends, you can give us a thumbs up on whatever platform that you're watching on, and you can drop us a comment because the algorithm absolutely loves comments. And if you want, you can even comment about how gruff my beard is or how hilarious my voice sounds. I'll tell you a little more about the beard in a second, to be honest, because I was shooting some videos for Victory recently, I started them about 10 days ago with quite a thick beard, and I'm very bad at trimming my beard. It's like an all or nothing thing. So I, it's like feast or famine with me with beard. But so basically what happened was I shot the videos and then I set about to shot the talking thing and my voice went and it's been gone for days. So I had to shoot the talking stuff in very small segments over the course of a few days, and I've had to keep my beard really long for continuity, and I just haven't. I finished up yesterday and now I'm desperate to shave it off, but it's fine. We shall persevere. I'll try not to cough all over you guys, by the way. As you can tell, pretty ill, but that's neither here nor there. I actually feel physically absolutely fine. It's just my voice that's gone and just cough. So anyway, listen, let's check in with the stream. Let's see how you guys are doing. We got a bunch of friends, new and old, through the door already. Marcin was predictably first one in, says, hi guys. Hi Nick, hi guys. First one again. Yeah, Marcin, I knew you would be, man. Like, you have to hold the record for most first through the doors. I feel like there's got to be an award in there somewhere. Anyway, Sacred Godslayer says, hi Marcin, hi guys, hi Nick. PJ is also in the house at 7:09 p.m. says, hi Marcin, fancy seeing you here. One day, mate, one day. Hi Nick, SGS and all. Yeah, man, you'll get in first one day. I'm sure you've been first a couple of times at least, but I love this little race to be first. So PJ has a question that we're going to be addressing specifically in this stream, which is, quick question, Nick, on picking strategies, you pick at 142 BPM, 16th notes. I can only pick at 120 BPM currently, so what is the best course of action to take to continue progress, please? Well, the first thing is that if we take a look at the tempos you've quoted, excuse me a moment, you are pretty much all the way there. It might not feel like it, but you know, 120 is a lot closer to 142 than say 20 is, or say quarter notes at 120. So you're pretty well on the way to getting it, my man. But we'll give you some actions that you can take over the course of this stream that I think you guys will find useful too, because it kind of falls under the remit of what we're here to talk about anyway. We've got some great advice coming in too from our stream community. I love the fact that you guys are helping each other out with this. Speaking of which, we've got some stuff on that community forum that you guys were asking for. I'll tell you more about that as the stream goes on. Nothing concrete yet, but we are working on it. So anyway, David Yates says, evening guys, evening Nick, as Vic Reeves and Bob Mortimer would say, we really want to see those fingers. Being a big Kiko fan, I work really hard on the economy of motion in my hands. Not easy though. Kiko is just a monster. I saw him at a clinic in Guildford recently. In fact, it was the day before the last shoot I did with Anderton's, and oh man, what a nice guy, but what a phenomenal player, just outrageous. I know what you mean about the economy of motion. The cool thing with Kiko is Kiko's teachings, a lot of it is a very refined reiteration of the old school shred teachings, just, you know, like put together in a really intelligent and really well digestible way, if that makes sense. So yeah, there's some really great stuff in there. We'll talk about that too. I'm going to star that up. That's a great comment. We'll come back to that. So Rick Elliott is in the house. Nick, caught your video on the open slot Takamine's, great job. Hey, thanks man, I appreciate it. That was a lot of fun. I do like doing the old acoustic reviews. There's not a whole lot you can talk about. You can't talk about for example, like pickup outputs and things like that. You have to just kind of focus on the nature of the guitar, and I really like that. So Nick, caught your job, where did we get to? Caught your video on the open slot Takamine's, great job, thanks man. The spruce top walnut model is a fantastic sounding guitar. Any chance you consider a classical review? I certainly would. Cordoba series Artist Pro Negra, yeah, would love to look at one of those, man. I think we have a relationship with the guys from Cordoba, so yeah, you know what it is, if you recommend it then we will look into it. That sounds great. I do love myself a bit of classical guitar. I can't really play classical guitar, but I think that's part of the fun. Similar to when I do the bass reviews. So I'm not a bass player, but I like to do bass reviews because a lot of you guys are guitar players who want to dabble in some bass. And I feel like my perspective is actually quite useful there, as opposed to maybe the perspective of a seasoned bass veteran who maybe isn't the musician that you are. So, hey, who knows? Anyway, who else do we have? Sacred God says with some great advice. Oh, Kim has beaten me to the punch. Regarding the forum. So Marcin and Sacred Godslayer, we're looking through forum/community options at the moment, and we'll update you once we have a solid plan. For sure, you know, we've been chatting about this behind the scenes. I think it's a really great idea. There is actually a very cool thing that I want to implement on the back of that, that's going to give us, i.e. me and you, the viewer, more access to each other outside of these streams, because I'd love to talk to you guys, and I'd love to be able to answer your questions in more detail about the courses that you're studying. So yeah, members forum is coming, but we don't just want to give you just a blank members forum where it's just like, okay, here you go, here's a white label forum. We really want to do something cool that is kind of befitting of the platform we've put together, because we're really proud of GI Plus, so we'd like to do something very, very cool with it. So anyway, who else do we have? We've got a bunch of people joining us in mourning the sad passing of Jeff Beck. Man, what a shocker. Holy, I can't swear this early in the stream. Man, that was a sickener. Like, it really, really was. So, you know, I mean, of course you guys know who Jeff Beck was, and you know his work. We're not going to dwell on that because, you know, we've all had our own private outpourings of grief, but man, that was a real sickener. Cowcats hit a nail on the head. Eddie and then Jeff. I mean, yeah, for real. Anyway, Marcin's got some great advice regarding the metronome. We're going to come back to that in a second. Foghorn is just here. We've got a great question from Obscure Guitar by Skip Newman. Great username. Working on Descending Legato. We'll talk about that. We're going to flag that up too. Timothy Appling is in the house. Steve McDee is in the house. Who else do we have? Blue Sumlin is in. Our friend Philippe Martelli is in the house. Is it Philippe or Felipe? I want to say it's Philippe, but I think Felipe would be an F if I'm not mistaken, but I don't know. Definitely not just faking these coughs. They are definitely coming out. I just don't want to cough all over you guys. That one caught me by surprise, though. Who else do we have? Mike Seedorf is in the house. Miguel is in the house. Miguel, it's great to see you. Our new friend. Ooh, let's see now. how am I going to pronounce this? For Freddy, I want to say, or Jeff Reddy, who knows, is in the house. We got some spam from Twitch. People are actually watching. Can you believe that? There we go. That is the running joke. Nobody watches us on Twitch. We're always live on Twitch. Nobody's watching us. Who else do we have? Oh, yeah, don't forget, by the way, drop us a comment. We want to hear from you. We'll be answering your questions live at the top of the hour. Who else do we have? Ah, here we go, right? Mike Seedorf, what do you think about the upward-downward picking techniques by Troy Grady? I think they are absolutely foundational. I think we have had a... pardon me. I think we've had an Isaac Newton moment with the way we think about picking with Troy's work. So Troy's research is, we all owe him a debt of gratitude. And the cool thing about Troy is not hoarding this to himself. He's not. He's a scientist in the truest sense that he wants to commit. Sorry, he wants to, contribute to the way that we think and the way we talk about guitar technique. So he's not making these proprietary things that only he talks about. And if you use the words downward pick slanting, he'll sue. It's nothing like that. I've spoke to Troy about this via email. Couldn't be cooler about it. So I've actually used a lot of those thoughts in my own teachings, including in picking strategies, which is kind of an expansion from that, I guess. But my own refinement thereof. Who else do we have? Thomas Ross is in the house. Says, thanks, Marcin. Who else do we have? Mal Riley in the house. Ever played Ibanez crossover six string crossover six string bass guitar that plays like a normal six string? That is wild. I have not, but I have an Aria guitar just off camera, which is a 30-inch scale B to B baritone, but could be tuned E to E. It's very, very cool. Very cool indeed. Mark Manish has a great question we're going to answer in the Q&A. We'll come back to that. And finally, Troy is not Gibson. Yeah, I can agree with that. 100% agree with that. So anyway, listen, let's get into the meat of today's stream. If you have questions, drop them down below. We'd love to hear from you. And if you have comments, again, we'd love to hear from you. This is a collaborative process. You guys help guide what we're doing in these streams. But we're going to be attacking some exercises to develop your chops, let's say, on the guitar, your chops. But it's not necessarily going to be quite as cut and dry as you might think. I'm not going to give you loads of exercises. I'll give you one or two maybe, but rather we're going to focus on designing exercises together. And I think the process is way more important than... and the process of designing these exercises is way, way more important than the actual exercises themselves. There are no magic exercises. It's all down to your personal goals, your preferences, and all that sort of thing. So we'll come back to that. Anyway, in the meantime, I'm going to show you this. What I want from you guys is, while we're watching this wee bit on picking strategies, I want to know what aspects of your technique you want to work on. We've got some stuff already, but tell me what you want to work on. When we come back, we're going to be designing some exercises for your personal goals. But in the meantime, this is our latest course. It's called Picking Strategies Part 1. Tell us what you want to work on. We'll see you in a little bit.
Does your picking feel uncoordinated and sometimes you miss notes or fluff transitions from string to string, maybe a little bit like this? When in reality what you want is smooth and easy and transparent feeling picking, a bit like this. Or maybe you've been sold on the idea that there's one specific way that you have to pick on the guitar and everything else is wrong, but that particular cookie cutter approach just doesn't work for you. It feels unnatural. It almost feels like you're fighting your own body to try and make it work. Well, Picking Strategies Part 1 is the course for you. In this course, we explore the many different ways that you can form a full and complete and comprehensive picking approach by examining the various strategies used by some of the greatest pickers of all time. And there are a whole bunch of strategies out there, and I guarantee there is one that is going to work for your preferred picking mechanics, the way you prefer to stand or sit with the guitar, the type of guitar you play, the type of music you play. There is a strategy for you. We're going to explore all of them, and I'm going to show you how you can take a single solo study and play every line within it using all of the six picking strategies that we look at in this course. And of course, this entire course is available as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you're not signed up already, what better excuse do you need to sign up today?
So that's a little look at picking strategies part one, and a reminder what my voice is supposed to sound like. Oh no, listen to it, listen to how ruined it is. I'll have it back by next week, I'm sure. But anyway, listen, also my hair is a mess. What am I doing, man? This is what happens when I'm ill. So anyway, listen, let's get into it. We've had some great suggestions already. You guys have come out with some great suggestions about the stuff that you want to work on and the exercises that you want to develop. I'm going to flag a few of them up. We're going to try and keep it mostly technique oriented today. So we've got some musical suggestions. I will be attacking those two. But we're focusing mainly on finger exercise today. Excuse me. I'm going to try and mute the mic as much as I can when I'm coughing because, man, it's not pleasant for you guys to hear, I'm sure. So anyway, listen, let's see what we have. So Steve McDee's come through with sweep picking. I want to highlight PJ's thing about quick question on picking strategies about picking faster. So there's two. So there's sweep picking, picking faster, descending legato. We've had a good one. There are some musical ones like fretboard knowledge and memory. I'll talk about those more in the Q&A. So we will get onto that. We've got a good one on finger warm up. We've got one on cascades with empty strings. Very cool. It's a great shout. We have another one from Frank saying playing a chord, then some notes, then a chord again, some notes like Chuck Berry. That's an interesting hybrid of the two. So there are a few things we can talk about here. We can talk about developing lines, which is something we will address. But I want to talk to you about the act of building exercises. So I guess before we do this, we need to define what an exercise is. So let's define our terms. We're going to go to the close-up cam for this. So an exercise would be, for example, if I wanted to develop my alternate picking, which in this case would be playing down and up. Let's play, for example, the C major scale, which might read 8, 10, 12, 8, 10, 12... 9, 10, 12, 10, 12, 13. I was distracted by my delay. I'm going to turn that off because that's quite annoying. If I wanted to develop this, that's not in itself a musical activity. It is, because scales are inherently musical devices. Robin Ford talked about this, said never be afraid to play a scale from bottom to top, because a scale is by its very nature a musical device. So, you know, if Robin Ford says so, it must be true. But I'm not doing this in a musical sense, in that I'm not trying to make music with this scale at this point. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to refine my technique. This is the difference between practicing and, let's say, playing. Now, you can play, you can practice with the view to refining your musicality, and that's something we'll talk about as well. But as far as technique goes, practicing and playing, different things. So if I wanted to practice this particular scale or this particular discipline, what I might do is I might devise a series of tasks for myself that would focus on the alternate picking aspect of this. So if I was to play this, for example, that is not a very good way for me to practice my alternate picking, because I'm not doing alternate picking, I'm playing downstrokes. Likewise, this. Not a very good way to practice my alternate picking, because downstrokes, because not downstrokes, legato, we've done the downstrokes bit. So those would be examples of things that aren't exercises for alternate picking. An alternate picking exercise might be something like this. It could be as simple as playing the scale from bottom to top, or playing the scale in groupings like this. I might play groupings of three. Or I may play in groups of strings. I might play three strings and then step back when I do it again. skipped one there. All of these are examples of exercises, but they are kind of superficial in terms of what we might consider an exercise. I'm going to give you a little bit of guidance on how to design an exercise. So to my mind, an exercise on the guitar, a finger exercise, should have at least these three qualities. And they all start with S, which is handy, right? So what we've got are the qualities that it should be specific, it should be scalable, and it should be sustainable. Let's talk about what they mean. So let's start with specific. So specific is the idea that your exercise should be specific to the thing that it is you're trying to work on. So if you're trying to work on legato, you should probably do some legato exercises, but you may want to drill down a little deeper into exactly what it is about your legato that you're trying to work on. So our friend from earlier on, who do we have? Obscure Guitar by Skip Newman, was talking about descending legato. So we're getting a little more specific here. This is not just, oh, I'm just going to work on my legato. Just legato, well, what does that mean? I'm just going to play loads of hammer-ons and pull-offs like this. I'm just going to play all the hammer-ons and pull-offs and a bunch of licks that I already know. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about specifically descending legato. Well, what might that involve? It's going to involve pull-offs. It's going to involve crossing to strings that are lower than the one we're on. It's going to involve probably position shifting in this direction. So those things, those qualities of pull-offs, crossing to new strings in this direction, and position shifting in this direction are going to give us a bit more specificity about our descending legato exercise. So that's an example of specificity. Let's talk about something being scalable. So what do we mean by scalable? Well, an exercise is no good if you can't progress on that exercise, because the goal of the exercise is to enable you to progress on it so that you can reach your goals. You know, if your goals are to play clean, fast, descending legato, if you don't have an exercise that you can measure your progress on, well, it's probably not really worth doing. So ways that we do this, we do it in terms of, with scalable, we mean we look for ways to make the exercise more difficult over time. Now, this doesn't have to be done with speed, but that's the most obvious way to do it. So if we took, for example, some drums and we would play our drums at, let's say, 90 BPM, which might sound like this. Hopefully you guys can hear the drums. 90 BPM. And let's say we set ourselves the task of playing eighth notes at 90 BPM. And we were going to descend down our C major scale with legato in groups of six. We might get this. A very, very simplistic exercise, but if we were to scale that, we could scale it to, say, 100 BPM, which makes it a little more challenging, where we might get something like this. And then if we scale it again to, say, 120, we might get something like this. So that's an example of something being scalable. It's an exercise that we are able to scale in terms of difficulty. So there's two things. Another way that we might scale it is we might scale it by making things more awkward. We might scale it by making it more challenging. So we may begin with just doing that, but then we might set ourselves the task of scaling it at 90 BPM, pardon me, by doing more repetitions like this. Or we may scale it by changing the finger we start on. So instead of starting on this fourth finger, which is rhythmically convenient, we may start on this third finger. Ooh. So on and so forth. So there are ways that we can scale our exercise. Now, sustainable, what we mean by sustainable is that you can do this for a long period of time without it messing you up, without it hurting or causing discomfort or having a negative impact on other aspects of your playing. So if you decided to attack your legato descending by playing this ungodly stretch, let's go to the close-up cam, that already hurts. Ouch, I don't like that. That would be an example of an exercise that is not sustainable. It's not sustainable. Likewise, an exercise that causes you to build a lot of tension and just maintain that tension, and you just kind of all bound up with rage and tension in your hands. And that would be another example of an exercise that wouldn't be sustainable. So to recap, all of our exercises are going to exhibit these qualities. They're going to be specific, they're going to be scalable, they're going to be sustainable. I want you to write that down if you have something to write it down on, or revisit this later on and take a note of it, because these are going to be guiding principles when it comes to designing our exercises. So let's go back to the comments, see what else has come in. We've got some great comments coming in from you guys. Always a pleasure to hear what you guys have to say on this. Alan Ross is in the house. Alan has stolen my voice. That is, I am his voice, he has my voice. Anyway, we've got a really good one here, right? David Yates says, a big problem for me is I press down too hard with my fretting hand. That is interesting. Now, we've actually got some exercises that we could drill into for this too. Very quickly, Metal says, an Iommi lesson maybe, anything to improve my blues and metal playing. We have an Iommi tech session. Right, Tony Iommi tech session, we've got it. It's in GI Plus. I did it. It's great fun. I had so much fun putting it together. An absolute joy it is. I got an SG for it, borrowed an SG and everything. It's really, really killer. And this Laney supergroup that we had, it was class. So yeah, we got one of those. So let's talk about some of our goals. We're going to add David Yates' problem to the list, right, which is pressing down too hard with the fretting hand. Let's talk about some exercises, first of all, that we can do for this. I want your suggestions, but I have some suggestions too. So an example of this might be to spend some time. Here's a good one, right? Here's a good one. If you want to drill onto your exercise for pressing down too hard with the fretting hand, right? If you find that you press too hard with the fretting hand, it can be very difficult to move your other fingers if one finger is pressing down too hard. So what you might do is you might assign one finger to be a static finger. Nick Harrison showed me this. So a static finger might be our first finger in this case. Let's put that on the high E string and let's keep it static. And then with our second, third, and fourth fingers, let's just play frets 6, 7, 8, 6, 7, 8. And you guys can do this with me, right? So we're gonna play 6, 7, 8 on the next string. All the way to the top. Now, if you're pressing down really hard, that is going to be almost impossible to do. So what you're going to need to do is it's going to force you to lighten your touch, like this. So we might need to go, again, with a lighter touch. Excuse me, guys, the cough is coming. I'm going to keep doing that all the way across the stream. So as long as I can mute the mic, then I'm happy. So what you may do to scale that is you could scale up with tempo, but we could also change which finger is the static finger and which string it's on. So let's get the static finger. Let's make our second finger the static finger. This is going to be a pain. Let's play fingers 1, 3, 4, 1, 3, 4. So we get this. Again. Now, if we put the static finger in the middle of our neck, this is going to make it harder again, because then we have to pass from one side of the string to another. So let's say we put our static finger, which is the middle finger in this case, on the G string. We could play 5, 7, 8 on the D string, and then onto the B string, like this. That is very hard to do with too much finger tension. Very hard to do with too much tension. Now, another thing we could do with this, you'll notice this with the tension thing, is we can try playing with certain limitations with what we do with our fingers. So we can limit ourselves to, for example, one finger down at a time. That might work really, really well. So if we played some scale lines, let's say we took, let's go back to 90 BPM on our drums. Nick Harrison, great exercise. Well, it's one of yours. You would say that. So anyway, an example of this might be if we would take all of our... what was I saying? Yeah, if we take, let's say, a G major scale for argument's sake, right? And we were to limit ourselves to one finger down at a time. This is all to address David Yates' problem about having too much pressure with his fretting hand, right? If you have too much pressure, you'll probably find that having a lot of fingers down at the same time is probably part of the issue. We've also got some stuff with the thumb. I was coming to the thumb. Don't worry about that, we're getting to the thumb. So what we might do is we might try playing this and make sure that we only have one finger down at a time. way to play per se. It's certainly a way to make sure that we're not squeezing super, super hard. But here's another one, right? We talked about the idea of the thumb being a generator of tension. So a lot of tension can come from the thumb. So what we can do is we can try and eliminate thumb tension by doing a few things. I'm going to start by taking some inspiration from Olympic weightlifters, if you can believe that, right? Olympic weightlifters will do all sorts of variations. They only do two lifts. There are two lifts, right? There is the snatch and the clean and jerk. And man, you know what it is? It takes a lot of thought to really get some variation in your training when you only do two lifts. So what they tend to do is tend to do lots of variations like snatch from the hang, etc. But there's a very cool one I like, which is the no foot, no hook snatch or clean. Let's take the snatch, for example. What that means is you do the snatch as normal, but you don't move your feet. Your feet stay put. You're not allowed to jump, but also you're not allowed to use your hook grip. So we can do a similar thing with the guitar, which would be no thumb scales. So we might play some scales with no thumb. And then we might add the thumb in as we go. So here's an example, right? Let's take G major. We're going to run G major up and down. We're going to play no thumb. So the thumb is off the fretboard. I'll put it here so you can see it. We might get this. Still there. It's off the fretboard. It's just hidden behind my hand. No thumb scales. Now, here's another thing, right? What we might do is we might do thumb off, thumb on. So you might do thumb off for a string, thumb on for a string. So let's do thumb off, thumb on, 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 thumb off. Got a bit confused by the turnaround there because I was trying to say thumb on, thumb off without a voice. But having the ability to actually take your thumb on and off as we go, you can't do that if you have a lot of tension in your hand. That's not to say this is a good way to play, but it's a good way to practice this stuff. It's a good way to practice having less tension in your hand because we're doing things that are specific to relieving tension, if that makes sense. Now, here's another thing we can do with this, right? Here's another thing. Cowcat's got a very cool suggestion, a calibration exercise that we've talked about before. That works really, really well. But another thing we might do with this, with our thumb off, thumb. Can you believe that? There you go. Thumb. Another thing we might do with our thumb on, thumb off exercise, in terms of scalability, is we might try taking the thumb off on specific notes. So we might try taking the thumb off every time we play, let's say, an A. So we might get thumb off. Very hard to do, very hard to do, because it forces you to be light as we go. Now, that's an example of creating an exercise. You'll notice this is not an exercise that I had previously. I've created this specifically for our circumstance here. So that's the thought process about creating exercises. You generate exercises based on the things that you want to work on. So let's do some more, right? Let's work on PJ's question about picking faster. So there is an interesting facet to this that I want to talk about, but examples of picking faster, you may start by finding things that you can pick at this speed. So I'm willing to bet there are certain things you absolutely can pick at 142 BPM. So we're going to steal some stuff from Troy again, because I've stolen loads of stuff from Troy. But if you can't pick this, for example, let's go to the target speed, which would be this. So if this gives you trouble, then I'm willing to bet you can probably pick something at that speed. Maybe this. Let's try that together, right? So that's probably something that we can pick. So that can probably work, right? And I'm willing to bet you could do probably this as well. From there, it's really a matter of scale. It's a matter of how much do we put in there. So a few guys suggested this already about short bursts, but short bursts of speed can be really, really useful. Now, if you can't play that at the appropriate speed, that's okay. You can find a speed where you can play it. Let's say, for example, we took 120, which you said you can play at, which would give us this. Let's say, for example, we're going to play a descending lick. We're playing together on this one. We're playing 8-7-5 on the high E string. We're going to play it twice. I missed that completely because I'm fumbling with my pick when I decided to play. So we might get... Let's go again. Once again. Close up cam so you can see the pick in hand. Let's go... Again. What we might do here is we might start creeping this up in increments. Now, I like increments of 4 BPM. Because I don't think you can really hear anything narrower than that. So 4 BPM, I like to move it up 4. So let's go to 1, 2, 4, which we're at now. We go, let's see if that works. And again, and again. Then we might go a little further. We might go up to, let's say, 1, 2, 8. And let's pretend that we hit a limit here, which is going to be at 1, 3, 2, where we go. And it's tough, but it starts to fall apart. That's okay. What we're doing there is we've established an upper boundary where beyond that, things aren't working. But that's okay. So what we can do there is we can just back things down to our previous increment, which was 128, and we can work there for some time. Now, the more you work here, the easier it will become, and that will enable you to push into higher tempi. You don't get results with this by forcing into territory you can't do. You get results by living in territory which is at the bounds of what you can do for a significant period of time. And then you make adaptations through your practice, and you know, you develop the adaptations you're looking for, and then you are able to play faster. That's generally how it works. There's not really a trick to it beyond that. Now, other things with this is identifying trouble spots where you might have issues picking at speed. So let's say, for example, that's caused you no problem, right? You can pick that at 1, 4, 2. That's no problem. What about if we include the next note in the scale? Does that cause any problems? If that does, if suddenly that causes issues, then we found a sticking point. We found a point where the trouble is coming in, and it's on the string cross, which is quite common for guitar players. Crossing strings, the hardest part about picking. So that might be something where you may spend more of your time, because if this is something you can do as fast as you like, but this just becomes horrible every time you do it, then it behooves us to spend more time there. So if we find that limit where we can play stuff, and then we experiment with the different parts of the lick and find the bit where we stumble, then that's where we should be spending our practice time. So we might devise an exercise that would focus primarily on that part. So the way this might work is we might just play that over and over again in clusters. And we may start with the downstroke. So we get, let's go. Then with an upstroke. Down. Up. Etc. We may do it again, but we may just shorten the number of notes we play at the beginning. So we may go. And again with an upstroke. That's hard. No, it's not. And so on and so forth. And then we might take that and cross that across strings. So we may go. So again, this is taking inspiration from Guthrie Govan, but it's also taking a little bit of inspiration from the way powerlifters train. It's all about gym stuff today. But if there's something that gives you problems, put a pause there. So sweep picking is an example. Steve McDee talks about this, right? Sweep picking. So I'm going to suggest that most people don't struggle with the outside part of a sweep arpeggio. A typical sweep arpeggio, like maybe this one, maybe this. Maybe I am today. But I'm ill, so I'm allowed to. So this will be an example of an A-shaped D major arpeggio, right? Most people don't struggle with this bit or this bit. They seem to take care of themselves. It's the stuff in the middle that's the issue. So what we might start doing is we might start adding pauses after every string. So we may start going like this. That's hard. That's really hard. Ah. Let's get some drums so we can do this at speed. A tempo, rather. Let's slow the tempo down a bit as well. So let's go real quick. Somewhere down here, let's go. Hard. I need to practice that. That's tough. So that would be an example of adding a pause to target a difficult part, of what you're trying to work on. What you guys will notice with this is that we are using these exercises. We're using these exercises to target specific things. These are specific. Right, specific choices to target specific aspects of our playing, which satisfies that first criteria of specific. Let's get into some more. So I'm going to give you some more exercises that we might do if you don't necessarily have a specific thing to work on, but we have something like this, which is a finger warm-up from our friend Blues Sumlin. Now, let's talk about what a finger warm-up actually entails. So a warm-up is something that prepares you to play at close to your best of ability. Similar to how a warm-up in you know, other physical activities may prepare you to perform well and hopefully prepare you to, you know, not get injured and stuff like that. It's performance related. It's also, I mean, guitar injury is not such a risk as maybe, you know, going and running a marathon without a warm-up. You should maybe warm up before you do that. Or, you know, getting under a barbell with your one rep max on it. Maybe you should warm up for that. Playing the guitar, it's more of a performance issue than anything else. We want to be able to play well. So the way we might think about this, we might think about preparing our play, preparing our fingers to play. That's the way we might think about warming up. Now, this is going to be important because a warm-up should not be in the same, it shouldn't have the same level of challenge that an exercise does, that practice does. So warming up and practicing, not the same thing. It is conducive to do a warm-up before you practice, but your practice is not a warm-up, if that makes sense. You wouldn't practice immediately before a gig. You would warm up. So what we might do with that is we might start looking for general qualities that we want. So what do we want, first of all? Well, we need the ability to move our fingers independently of each other. So what's that going to look like? Well, we might do something like this. Let's say, for example, we took that good old-fashioned spider exercise. Everybody knows and hates because it's just, it's really quite redundant. Yes, it's fine, but it teaches you just to do this over and over again. Where we can play it backwards, there are better ways we can do this. Ways we might do it is we might start just by randomly eliminating one finger, right? So we might eliminate the first finger. We might play this. Then we might eliminate the second finger. Then eliminate the third finger. Then eliminate the fourth finger. Then we might do it backwards, like this. Eliminate the first finger. Eliminate the second finger. Eliminate the third finger. Eliminate the fourth finger. Then we might try moving our eliminated finger to another string, because we need to be able to cross strings. So let's eliminate our, instead of eliminate our first finger, let's just put it on the next string, and we'll play whatever finger is on the next string last. So we'll get this. Okay, let's move the second finger up there, we'll play that last. Let's put the third finger up there. Let's put the fourth finger up there. Let's do the same thing, but this time let's move it down a string. So let's go to the D string. Same deal. Let's just move our first finger down a string. So let's go, let's play that one last as well. Let's take our second finger. Let's put that down. We'll play that last. Let's take our third finger. We'll put that down. Let's play that last. And let's put the fourth finger down. Let's play that last. Now, if you've been following along with this, you may have noticed that some of these are significantly more challenging to you than others, and that's normal, right? That happens. We have blind spots in our playing, so, you know, that's normal. So what you might find with this is, if we do this sort of stuff, for example, pardon me, very distracted by this cough. If we do it at this kind of pace, for example, let's go. Where it feels very easy, that might be a warm-up. But if we were to play it at a harder speed, it's the same exercise, but it could be practice, which would be this. Then. There's some things we need to be able to do. What else do we need to be able to do? Well, we need to be able to shift positions. So what if we were to do some position shifting exercises? Well, what's that going to look like? We need to be able to shift with our fourth finger and our first finger. So what if we were to play something like this, for example? Let's make one up. Let's go. Let's show you what's going on there. So here I'm playing frets 4 and 7 with my first and fourth finger, and I'm playing from 4 to 2 and back down to 4 again, and then with our fourth finger I'm playing 7, 9, 7. Literally just made it up, right? So I play this with an intensity that is warm-up kind of intensity, like this. To make it harder, I can make the position shift bigger. I can go here. Oops. I can also increase the speed. That's hard. Very hard. That'd be an example of some position shifting that we might want to do. Other things we might want to do, we might want to be good at bending strings. So we may take our spider exercise that we wanted to do before, let's say, and we may take any one of these notes, maybe not the first finger, but let's make it so that we have to bend up to one of the notes at random. So let's say instead of playing the second finger, we have to get it with a bend. So we get there. What about if we did that, trying to get all the third finger notes from the bend? Fourth finger notes of the bend, let's go. What about if we decided we want to go further, like this? That's a fun exercise, I like that a lot. Thank you. very challenging, but it's good fun. Now, what if we decided we wanted to put those all together to make like an all warm-up, if that makes sense, a total warm-up exercise? Well, we could do that. We could do position shifting. We could do bending. We could do finger independence. Let's go back to our spider exercise with, let's say, pardon me, fingers 1, 2, 3, 4, and displacing a finger. But we're going to play it in fifth position, and then we'll play it up in 12th position, and then back again. So we might get, well, let's not make it as big as that. Let's make it 7th position. Let's go 5th position, 7th position. So we might go like this. Oh, that was going to be last, wasn't it? So we might go. That position shift is really difficult. Let's put the second finger up a string. Once I've done this, I'm gonna feel thoroughly warmed up, right? So what I might do there, everyone's gonna bend on, is I might just put a bend on the last note. This up, just literally devised an exercise there. That's the point. These are not exercises that you remember. They're not magic exercises that if you play this, then you know the guitar is yours. That's not how it works. We've devised exercises specific to our needs, and that is a little bit on how I think you guys should devise your exercises for your own practice stuff. So what I want to see from you is if you come up with any cool exercises like this sort of stuff, drop me a message with them or tag us with them on Instagram. We haven't done that in ages, right? Upload it to Instagram, tag us at Guitar Interactive Magazine, tag me at Nick Jennison. We're going to do your questions when we come back, right? So Q&A stuff, we'll be talking about some more musical stuff as well. We haven't got long, so we'll go as quick as we can. But before we do, just want to take a moment to show you this. This is another course from us right here at Guitar Interactive. This is Mastering Modes Part 1. So if you're struggling with the whole modes thing or with the idea of converting pentatonic scales, which you know and love, into bigger musical devices, this is probably the course for you. When we come back, your questions.
Modes. What are modes? How do I use them? When do I use them? Well, modes are one of the things that the pros use to add excitement and color to the guitar parts, and there is no reason why you can't use them too. Now, for some reason, people, especially certain online guitar teachers, love to make modes seem complicated and scary, but I'm here to tell you they really, really aren't. And in fact, if you know the pentatonic scale, I can show you how to play modes with just two extra notes. In this course, I'll show you how to play careless sounding guitar solos using modes without any of the mystery. You'll learn how to play musical sounding solos all across the neck in any key, crucially without sounding like you're just running up and down scales. So, if you're ready to take this next step with me, click the link to find out more.
So that's a little look at Mastering Modes Part 1. You guys have seen that, but in case you're new to the stream, I wanted to share that with you. This is all available as part of your GI Plus membership. You can get that at guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-plus. Link in the description, right? It's cheap as well. It's really cheap. pardon me, that is another cough coming up. That was terrible. These coughs keep coming to get me. But yes, GI Plus, you can get it down there. That's the place to go. All sorts of great guitar lessons, really affordable for what you're getting. There's an unbelievable amount of content in there. So we've got some great questions coming in, but I want to highlight one or two of them real quick. First of all, I want to address this, right? This is PJ's question that has just like permeated the entire chat today, because it's a really fascinating one about what happens when we get to certain speeds. So and why, when you get to 180 BPM, why can't we even count 16ths? Now, there is a really interesting phenomenon that goes on around 100 milliseconds. Now, 100 milliseconds is a very special time period, or a length of time in music, because our brain does weird things around 100 milliseconds. What do I mean by 100 milliseconds? Well, 100 milliseconds, if you think about it on a delay time, for argument's sake, if you have a delay pedal and you dial your delay to 200 milliseconds, you'll hear distinct repeats. Pop, 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 pop. If you dial it to 100 milliseconds, we start to get into the territory that we might think of as slap. So an example of a slap delay, I'll go to my clean sound where I happen to have one. An example of a slap delay might be something like this. Can you guys hear that? Let's throw the compressor on. Pardon me. That little slap is very interesting, because we don't really hear it as a distinct repeat like we might do in a long delay like this one. Let's turn the delay on. That would help. Now, those longer delays we hear as a specific rhythm, but we don't hear slaps as a specific rhythm, and it's because they're below a certain threshold. And for most of us, that happens somewhere around 120, give or take. It's different for different people. So another interesting thing with this is if we think about playing notes with 100 milliseconds between them, right, 100 milliseconds between them, we would call this the inter-onset interval. It's the space between two notes, space between the start of two notes. So if we took, for example, the idea of playing something like, oh, I don't know, let's say 60 BPM, right? 60 BPM, where we have 60 beats per minute, which means every beat is a second. So here we have, like, turn that delay off, that's annoying. Go away, delay. There it is. Couldn't hear the drums for the delay. So here, every note has an inter-onset interval of, let's just shut that down for a second, an inter-onset interval, a gap between the starts of the notes, of 1 second, right? Or 1,000 milliseconds, you might think about it as. If we played eighth notes at this pace, like this, here, all of our notes have an inter-onset interval, a gap between them, of 500 milliseconds. If we play 16th notes, we might get... an inter-onset interval of 250 milliseconds. Notice it's halving every time. And then if we play at 32nd notes, we would get an inter-onset interval of 125, which would be this. I'm going to encourage you to play along with me here, right? So we're going to play just an A on the high E string, right? Let's do quarter notes. And keep track of that, right? And I want you to mentally sing or verbally sing each note that we play. Let's do eighth notes. Let's go. Yeah, we can keep track of that. That's good. Let's do... I can't hear the drums for my own voice. Let's do 16ths. Here we're at 250. Okay, let's double that. Let's go 30 seconds. Now, something different happens there. When we get to that 30-second note interval, where we're at a distance of 125 milliseconds between the notes, we sort of stop thinking about them. We stop thinking about them as individual notes, and we start thinking about them more as units of notes. You might think about them as two notes at a time, butter, 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 or four notes, butter, da, da, butter, da, da, butter, da, da, butter, da, da. It's why people say guitarists go widdly, 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 because we can't process those individual notes at that sort of speed. And it's when notes get somewhere around that inter-onset interval of 100 milliseconds. Now, let's talk about where that is. 100 milliseconds, the inter-onset interval, 100 milliseconds, playing 16th notes, is 150 BPM. 150. So it's here. If we play 16th notes, there's quarters, eighths, 16ths. There's a very interesting threshold here where we're crossing between notes that we're able to process individually and notes that we have to what's called chunk. We've talked about chunking before. It's this data reduction method that our brain uses where we take things that are too much to process individually and group them together. That's what happens at around an onset interval of 100 milliseconds. Same thing happens with the delay. We talked about the slap thing. The same thing also happens with what's called the Haas effect. So if you're interested in audio production, the Haas effect is a very fascinating thing. It's a way of creating stereo width on an otherwise mono source. So you take a mono source, you delay it by a certain amount on one side, somewhere under 100 milliseconds, and we get a sense of spreading. But when we get up past the 100 milliseconds, it happens a little before that, but we get up past the 100 milliseconds thing, we start to hear them as separate sources. But when we get below, we start to hear them as one source only spread out. It's a really fascinating psychoacoustic phenomenon, but it has implications in our playing, because when we get up and around that 140, 150, 160 region playing 16th notes, we stop being able to focus on individual notes. And that has implications on how we actually think about them. We have to group them. We have to group them in little groups of four, let's say, or groups of three, or groups of as many as seven. Generally speaking, chunking happens between three and seven notes as a rule, somewhere around that. Eight sometimes, but I think most people experience eight as two lots of four. Personally. So that is one of the reasons why, if that makes sense. One of the reasons why. Here's an interesting one, right? We've got some more questions. Here we go. That delay sounds expensive, says Nick. It is expensive. It's an expensive delay with an equally expensive reverb on top. Yes, many expensive items of gear. What else do we have? Tony Gonzalez signed up last week. Hey, Tony, thanks. So appreciate that, man. Good of you to sign up. So, excuse me. He's asking, are you planning to do anything, or do you think you could put something together on odd time signatures? I'm thinking like a Pliny or prog type rhythm. That is a really great idea. So, you know, I am starring that up because that's a fantastic suggestion. We should definitely do that. Whether it's out in the immediate term, it's hard to say because we've got a pipeline of courses we want to get out. We've definitely got some stuff on playing metal rhythm that might tie into that. That's actually the next course that's going to drop. I'll let you guys be the first to know about this, by the way. When you're on the stream, you find out about new courses first, if that makes sense. So yeah, you know what it is? I think there's some stuff on that in there, but a whole course would be fantastic. I'd love to do that myself, but I wonder if we might draft in a specialist for it. Just thinking about it. Anyway, so yeah, that's a really, really great shout. So guys, listen, thank you so much for having me. I'm about to go and consume a whole bottle of cough medicine. Probably sleep for a day, because when you cough like this, you don't sleep. It's terrible. So listen, I'm going to go. I'm going to play some more. Thank you so much for having me. We're back next week. I will have my voice in its usual fit state. In the meantime, let's play ourselves out with some of... Oh, what am I going to play? I feel like I want to play something reasonably challenging, because we've been playing stuff... That's fairly challenging. Let's do the Lydian Alopecia Dream. This is a Joe Satriani style backing track. We'll get the expensive delay back out. And I'll do some descending legato. Why not? Because if you just do ascending legato, you run out pretty quick. So let's play some stuff. What are the chords in this? I'll have to remind myself. We'll find out. In the meantime, thanks for having me. I'll see you guys next week. Remember the changes before you start playing over them. I'll see you guys next week. Take care of yourself. This is what you get in your GI.
My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag? Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from Fusion Maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Colson Abassi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.